Welcome back, and in this lesson, I want to take a sample question that you might find in the exam and break it down. This should help you to understand the process I go through when answering exam questions, and hopefully it will make you a little bit more efficient in the exam. Once again, this is another question taken from the tutorialsdojo.com Advanced Networking Specialty Practice Exam, and I'm using this question with their permission. So let's just jump in and step through the question. Now, this is another interesting style of question. Let's look through it first. So a company is migrating its on-premises application to AWS to save on server and storage costs. A total of 30 Amazon EC2 instances is expected to be used for the application. The network engineer must create a new VPC for the application and 10 Amazon S3 buckets to store the static files. What IP version 4 CIDR block should the engineer use for the VPC? Now, as always, it's a good default task to do keyword analysis on the question first. Give this a try while pausing the video and resume it once you're ready to compare the keywords that you identified with the keywords which I identified. Okay, let's have a look at what you identified versus what I identified. If you read through the question, you're going to spot a few key things. First, a migration requirement for 30 EC2 instances and 10 S3 buckets, and you're being asked what IP version 4 CIDR should the engineer use for this VPC. Now, the answers that we have are as follows. First, we have 10.0.0.0/29, 10.0.0.0/28, 10.0.0.0/26, and then finally 10.0.0.0/27. Now, this is a type of question which I refer to as a Goldilocks problem or a Goldilocks question. You might know the old children's story with three bears, where the food is too hot or too cold, the chairs are too big or too small, and the beds are too soft or too firm. This question is all about picking the right sized VPC for this requirement. Now, often you will be told that you need to pick the smallest valid answer. In this case, though, you're not told that. Now, there's one thing about this question which really jumps out at me personally. You'll see EC2 and S3 mentioned in the question. And you need to ask, do S3 buckets run in a VPC? Of course not, so you can go ahead and forget about that, focusing instead on the EC2 instances. Or can you? Well, you need to be careful not to read too much into questions, but for those EC2 instances to be able to access S3, they would need either a NAT gateway or be public instances or need interface or gateway endpoints. Now, none of that is mentioned, but keep it in mind in case we need it later on. My default, though, is that I can forget about the S3 buckets because they're not located within a VPC. Now, the next step really is to calculate how many IP addresses each of the answers has. This is another situation where you should start with something that you know. In this case, we know that a /24 range has 256 addresses, 0 through 255. Based on that, we can half that for a /25, half again for a /26, and so on. And this gives us 8, 16, 64, and 32. Addresses for answers A, B, C, and D. But there's more. Remember that AWS reserve a total of 5 IPs in every subnet. We can assume one subnet because there are none mentioned explicitly in the question, and this means that we have 3, 11, 59, and 27 usable addresses inside of AWS. It means that we know that answers A, B, and D are too small because we need at least 30, so only answer C is valid. Answer C also has the benefit of having spare capacity if we do need to use NAT gateways or interface endpoints. Now, the structure of this question is a Goldilocks question, so you need to evaluate the text in the question, review what each of the answers offers, and then quickly reach a conclusion. And this is another question where the ability to perform basic subnet style math, so binary to decimal conversion, is going to be a real advantage in the exam. If you're doing the Advanced Networking Specialty exam, then you do need to be able to perform this type of calculation without using any form of calculator. This is basic binary to decimal mathematics, and you need to be able to do this in an exam-style situation. Thanks once again to tutorialsdojo.com for allowing me to use this question for this lesson. I've attached a link to the Advanced Networking Specialty Practice Exam to this lesson, so do check them out if you want any additional practice questions above and beyond what I've included in this course. At this point though, that's everything I wanted to cover in this lesson, so go ahead and complete the video, and when you're ready, I'll look forward to you joining me in the next.